Hi guys, welcome to the Citizen Channel. I hope you're all very well, I hope you're all staying safe. And of course we have a little review of a big match today, so we're going to look back at the game. Comfortable win, wasn't it? A 2-0 win against Fulham in the Premier League on the 5th of December 2020. 3 p.m. kickoff. It'd be nice if you had these 3 p.m. kickoffs and we could actually be there to watch it, wouldn't it? But hey, there you go. Anyway, thanks for joining me for this. We'll have our usual features, the highlights and the lowlights of the game, some match talking points, match stats, quirky stats, of course, which some good ones today. Our pep here till 2023, perhaps, maybe, possibly watch. Rodri's Rocket Watch, yeah, we'll have a go at a Rodri's Rocket Watch, eh? It'd be quite an impressive one, really. Yeah, a bit more on that in a moment. Obviously, the Manchester Evening News, Mr. Bukowski's player ratings and my own player ratings, plus some media headlines from today and comments as we look back at the game. Please, if you're new to the channel, push that old subscribe button there. I've hit it. We've done it, lads. Thank you very much. We did hit. I wanted to hit 500 subscribers by Christmas 2020. As I'm doing this, we're at 501, so then that could go up and down. You know what it's like. But my appreciation to everyone. And please, if you can keep up the good work and pass the word, it'd be fantastic. Let's go on regardless and see what we can hit by Christmas 2020. It'd be nice, wouldn't it? It'd be nice to get about 550 by Christmas 2020. But I think I'm pushing it a bit there, to be honest with you. But let's see how we go. So keep up the good work, all of you there. And please check the playlist for all my City stuff, past and present. And of course, you will notice some film and TV stuff as well. So if you or anyone you know might be interested in that, just point me my direction and get them to sub as well. That'd be fantastic. It's great to know you out there. And I've had a guy I work with as well was sort of pushing me. He's a bit like an influencer, they're called, aren't they? You've got me half a dozen guys or something. So my appreciation there for that young man at my work. I won't name him. He's too embarrassed. He's a very, very shy gentleman. Anyway, right, here we go. What did we do? Starting lineup. Yeah, six changes to the Porto game. So starting 11 was Edison, Cancelo, Diaz, Stones, Mendy, Rodrigo, Gundogan, Mahrez, Kevin, De Bruyne was the captain, Sterling, Jesus. Subs, Stefan Laporte, Bernardo, Torres, Fernandinho, Foden and Garcia. Yeah, I got 9 right, so I was quite happy with that. I was surprised there was no Walker. I thought Walker would start today and obviously have a rest against Marseille, but that didn't happen, did it? I'm a bit surprised with that one. And obviously Sterling was a 50-50 chance, wasn't it? I did base it on Sterling not playing, but you know Pep, is it? Anyway, he wasn't predictable, Pep, was he? So I was quite happy with that. I mean, wasn't a lot of even lack of complaints about Foden not starting today. So that was quite interesting. Obviously, he's going to start the Marseille game. That's a shoo-in, isn't it? So he's going to have to prove himself in that if he wants to even have a chance at the derby next week. But can't see that happening, can you? Yeah, the officials today. Referee John Moss, assistants Mark Perry, Dan Robotham, fourth official Darren Bond, on VAR Mr. Graham Scott. We didn't have much use for him today, did we? Did we have anything VAR today? I don't think there's one single thing, was there? Assistant VAR was Matthew Wilkes. Oh yeah, he checked the pen, didn't he? Of course, yeah, that was, but nothing untoward on VAR anyway, so he did an okay job. I won't rate him, but he did an okay job. Yeah, on to the match, some highlights and lowlights. Yeah, there was a few closes, weren't there? So close. We had obviously Areola, as is the norm with the games at the Etihad, was on fine form for Fulham, wasn't he? On 3 minutes, he blocked a Sterling effort. Should Sterling have done better? I think he probably should have done, shouldn't he? These are all the so close things. I've just changed the way I do these little match things. 13 minutes is a great reflex save, wasn't it? A near flows from a deflected KDB effort. That was a fantastic save. That was just instinct, that, wasn't it? 32 minutes after an adept Mahrez golf chip, obviously Sterling tried to place his volley. I think he did it right. I think rather just put his foot through it. I think he did everything right. But obviously, again, Areola was more than equal to that, wasn't he? There was some efforts not even bothering, wasn't there, at Areola? There was an 11-minute Cancelo Rose Z effort. There was a 16-minute Gundogan 2 points for Wigan effort. And we have the Rodri's Rocket Watch. Yeah, we had a fantastic 24 minutes. A superb Rodri's Rocket that absolutely frightened the corner flag to death, didn't it? I think it probably hit the corner flag. It was that terrible. So, Rodri, you're letting us down, mate. You're struggling a bit with these Rodri's Rockets. Some lowlights before we talk of the highlights in the first half. The lowlights, obviously, 8 minutes, Adebayor had a great chance, didn't he, with a header, but I've noticed about five Fulham players at the back post queuing up to get. I don't know what the defence was doing, I don't know this zonal marking or whatever we have, but it just seemed to be five Fulham players. I think there was one City player there and five Fulham players, but fortunately Adebayor got the yips, didn't he, and obviously didn't want to score against us, obviously, being a past player, obviously. And then, obviously, we had the 30-minute Stones attempted back pass. He didn't look, obviously, but I have no idea why Ederson would even come off his line, to be honest with you. I mean, surely he gives Stones the option and stays on his line. Just a very, very poor... I mean, I do blame Ederson, but obviously communication between the two of them was pretty awful, to be honest with you. So, yeah, fortunately, it went wide for a goal kick, didn't it? So it could have been very, very embarrassing. So... More on that perhaps on Edison's score later, but I'm not going to treat him too harshly, to be honest with you. And the highlights, of course, well, it was 2-0 at half time, wasn't it? So there was a couple of highlights at least, wasn't there? Yeah, 5 minutes, wasn't it? We didn't have long to wait, did we? 5 minutes, a great goal, wasn't it? Sterling down his right. See, he can finish when he's on his right, can't he? It's when he's coming in from the other side he can't finish the goals. He had a couple of chances that first half, didn't he? He sort of placed it superb. Harry Ole had no chance. It was so, I mean, obviously his judgment of where he was, perhaps he thought it was going wide, I'm not sure, but he just give up on it, really, didn't he, Ariola? So it's a fantastic goal, again, with another KDB assist, of course. And, of course, 25 minutes, he won us the penalty, didn't he? At last, he learns how to go down a la Salah-style, Mane-style in the box when he's kicked, you know, that's what you should do, unfortunately. That's how it is. I mean, it was fouled, simple as, and he went down. Good lad. We know you're learning, mate. And, obviously, up-step Keb, no problem this time, obviously. He chose the other corner. Could I have said? I think I could have saved that, to be honest. I don't think it was right in the corner. I think I would have gone to my left for that one, to be honest with you, based on the fact he missed on the other side last time. So I would have played the percentages and gone left if I was saving that. As I said, if you watch my vlogs, I used to be a bit of a keeper. I used to be pretty good at saving penalties when I was in prime, and I could probably get down in sort of various sort of stages even now, you know, and perhaps have a chance. But yeah, at least it was comfortable, and that'll be good for his confidence, isn't it? Anyway, so it was 2-0 at half-time. Fulham, there was no real force within that first half. I think City had played quite well. I think confident, could have done better with a couple of the chances. Yeah, no notice there. I mean, I noticed Mahrez had a great second half, but not really much in the first half. So that was interesting. Well, everyone was raving over him to be man of the match. So let's see anyway. Yeah, second half, again, the so-close elements. KDB hit the bar, didn't he, on 50 minutes. I think he should have done better, to be honest with you. Some good play, interchange play between him and Jesus, wasn't it? 57 minutes, Mr. Areola again. Mr. Areola pulls out another good save from KDB, but again, he perhaps should have done better after a fantastic through ball by Mahrez, and obviously KDB only had the goalie to beat, and he made the save, unfortunately. So again, perhaps KDB could have done a little bit better. How about the so far aways? Yeah, we had a 65 minutes, a clever corner kick from Mahrez to KDB, who blasted it over. 70 minutes, another chance from a corner, but I don't know what Diaz was doing. I think he was a bit perturbed whether to head it or kick it, and in the end he kicked it, and it sort of didn't do anything, did it? It just sort of sliced it wide at the post. 73 minutes, Jesus, who had a pretty quiet game, really, didn't he? He panicked a bit, didn't he, by Adebayor. I think Adebayor was running up alongside him. He seemed to get the better of him, and then I think he's quite pacey, Jesus, isn't he, as well? But Adebayor's long legs sort of caught up with him. He must have scared him to death, because he just sort of let it feebly run out of play for a goal kick, didn't he? So that was a bit disappointing from Jesus. 77 minutes. Yeah, the last real thing of the game, wasn't it? I mean, it was typical KDB free kick to the far post. Diaz is there at the far post, but again, struggled, didn't he? He didn't know what to do with that one. He didn't know whether to head it or volley it. And in the end, it just shot. Flew wide, didn't it? So it's very good. That was, yeah, I was getting confused there, wasn't it? I think it was Diaz blasted over, didn't he? He actually... that earlier chance. I'm getting confused once it's, yeah, so it's like a headed opportunity and a blast and a shot chop opportunity. But either way, Diaz isn't, is, will he score? I mean, he obviously clears off the goal line for the opposition, you know, when he's got the goal gaping. So I mean, he's gonna be one of these guys that frustrates us, that always looks at, he can score for his national team, can't he? Why can't he score for us? Yeah, a couple of minutes of injury time, but it was all over by then, wasn't it? We could have perhaps done with a third. Fulham far better, weren't they? I mean, we'll have a just chat about Fulham in a minute. The ref watch, Moss, yeah, I mean, he looked good in that top, didn't he? A bit, yeah, he could do losing a few pounds, but obviously they must have fitness checks, mustn't they? So I know he does walk around the pitch a lot, but he does run occasionally. But yeah, I do worry about him, and he seems to do okay. I mean, he seemed to miss a couple of challenges on City players and let them go that perhaps were a bit iffy. There's one on Mendy where he nearly had his head off, but. Yeah, so I'm going to give him 5.5 out of 10. I'm not giving him the basic 6. I don't think he was that good. I thought it was okay, but I think he missed a couple of things. The match sum up, yeah, clean sheet's important. Of course it is again. Although Edison and Stones tried their best not to do that, didn't they? But not clinical enough again. We're not, are we? I mean, we didn't create masses of chances. We're not clinical enough in front of goal. And it's a very dour second half that. I mean, obviously, Pep deliberately didn't play subs, did he? And we'll talk about that as well. But yeah, we should have really put the game to bed. Because at 2-0, there's always a chance Fulham could get one back, even though they didn't. Bit weak up front, weren't they? But yeah, so we were always comfortable for our 2-0. As for Fulham, well, the opposition, I mean, yeah, it was a better second half by Fulham, but couldn't really take any advantage, could they, of City's average second half performance. I think we obviously dropped a little bit and they couldn't take advantage of it. They worked hard. We're fairly fit. They kept going all game, which is fair enough. I think the keeper's okay. He might be of help to him as he progressed through the division. But it is going to be a long season. I don't see anything that makes me think they're going to escape that top four or bottom four or five very quickly. I'm not sure if you've got. I think they've got an attacker on the bench today, didn't they? But I don't. Obviously, the attacking options look a bit weak. They're not well known for scoring goals, apart from what they did. They obviously scored 3 at Leeds, but apart from that, they don't really score a lot of goals. But I think they'll take confidence from this after beating Leicester last time at their place and doing okay at City to get away with a 2-0. I think they'll take more confidence, so I think that'll do them good as well. So it'll be interesting now to see how they go now over Christmas and see how it looks in the new year for Fulham. Match stats, shots 16 for City, which isn't a lot really, is it? 6 for Fulham, on target 6 for City, 1 for Fulham. Possession 70% to 30%, passes 787 to 343. Completion 89%, and that was up 92% or so in the first half. So again, it's happened a bit this season, we've sort of slacked off the second half in completion, passes completion. So that sort of says a lot really, doesn't it? Fulham just 77% completion. Fouls 7 by City, 6 by Fulham. Again, we always win that, don't we? We always seem to win the fouls count. Corners 9-3, and we could have had one or two goals. I mean, bit better finishing. We could have done all right from the corners. Right, player ratings. Mr. Bukowski sort of seems to take permanent role now as doing the Manchester Evening News player ratings. My minimums are 6 today. So. There's no one gets less than a 6, put it that way. So, but there's a couple of people who get a little bit more, but I'm not as generous perhaps as Simon's been with these. Edison, a relieved man as the ball rolled wide of the goals. He came out to retrieve it and saw John Stones knock it past him. Didn't have very much to do with this goal remaining untested. So give him a 6. I'm going to agree with a 6. As I said, I could have marked him down for that, but I'll a couple of good long kicks, etc. So I'll give him the basic 6. Cancelo, never shy to get forward, worked very well with De Bruyne. He did the work well together, constantly catching Fulham cold with his intelligent runs. Another excellent showing, even if a little quiet in the second half. Well, I think everyone was quiet in the second half. He's given him an 8, though. I wouldn't have given him an 8. Yeah, I think he did look dangerous going forward, but we're not doing anything. You know, we're not getting that final ball in him. We're not getting the goals. So, yeah, it's in the same way that Walker and Mendy used to annoy me, that they used to have these great runs and then they used to come to nothing. And Cancelo's doing a bit of the same at the moment. So unless it actually leads to something, you know, I mean, if defenders have managed to clear it, I'm not overly impressed. But I'll give him 0.5. So I'll give him 6.5, but Simon's give him 8. I mean, I'm not going to go that high. Diaz, he just exactly what City needed this season. always in the right place to prevent danger or cut it out. He has transformed the defence. He's given him another 8. Yeah, I mean, Simon's very generous today. I've given him a 7. I thought he did play really well. I mean, his partner, I'll give a 7 as well. Stones in a minute. But, yeah, he's giving him 8. I'll give him 7. Stones, credit also to Stones, who picked up his third consecutive clean sheet as he kept Laporte out of the team again. A nervy moment with Edison, yeah. Everything was comfortable. So he's only give Stones a 7 compared to Diaz's 8. I mean, I didn't think there's any real difference between them. So I'm going to give Stones a 7 as well. Mendy good against his tricky Anguissa. Didn't go forward as often as he can with Cancelo much more advanced, although that is not necessarily to his detriment as he kept a solid back line. Yeah, so he's giving him 7. Yeah, I wasn't all impressed with Mendy. I think it was okay, but I think he got caught a couple of times, you know, on the wrong side of players. So I've only given him a 6, which is the basic, but... No, he offered nothing going forward. I think he made some errors in defence, to be honest with you. Rodri is another one. Dropped back into defence, but also pushed on to drive City forward, showing an ability to break lines that he doesn't always use. One of Guardiola's most used this season. He looked like he could run all night. Well, yeah, he could run, but not very quick. I mean, he looked like you know, at least 2 or 3 times in the second half, he was just left for dead. He got no pace whatsoever. So what use was he? So he's given him an 8, Simon. I mean, I've just given the basic 6. I wasn't overly impressed with Rodri today. I know a lot of people are. I just thought he was terrible. I think Simon. Sometimes I think Simon's watching and other people watch a different player. But if I could have a camera on him all game and keep an eye on him, that might help, mightn't it? Gundogan, a quiet yet effective performance, ticking the ball over and helping Mendy on the left. A door left open for Bernardo or Phil Foden, though, probably. And he's given him a 7. Yeah, I've given him a 6.5. I thought he was better than average, but... I thought his distribution in the first half was pretty poor, actually. He had a better second half, which is unusual because the team didn't play that well the second half. But he did have, in my opinion, had a better second half, although the rest of the team didn't. He was probably one of our better players, like with Mahrez in the second half. But yeah, so I'll give him a 6.5. Simon's given him a 7. KDB produced one of the best bits of skill you see all season, his own third. Also bagged an assist and a goal, showed once why he's untouchable. And let's give him a 9. So let's give Kevin a 9. Yeah, I'll give him a 7. Perhaps a bit mean, but I just on the basis I thought the old team wasn't fantastic today, I'm just going to give him a 7, which is high. He's one of my highest score. But yeah, I wouldn't go as high as 9, but because everything goes through him, which is fair enough. But yeah, he could have done better with a couple of chances. Mahrez, Fulham did much better at keeping him quiet than Burnley did, although his exceptional touch still helped create a few shooting opportunities. Yeah, again, the second half, I thought it was very, very good. Simon's giving him 7, so I'll just give him 7 because of that 7 second half performance. So again, with KDB, he's one of the highest marks. And the same with this young man, Sterling. I mean, he did score a goal, didn't he? But he missed a good chance early on, said Simon. Much improved in the final third this season in terms of getting into the right area. So yeah, I thought it was okay, actually. One of his better games. He's not been fantastic. Simon's given him an 8. Again, I'll give him a 7, which is my joint highest mark with the other guy, Mahrez and KDB. But I'm only going to give him a 7 because he still missed things, didn't he? Another game without a goal for Jesus, although his general performance did contribute to the attack as ever. Looked sufficiently sharp without threatening the goal, yeah. So Simon's gives Jesus 6, so I'll reflect that. I say he should have done better with something, but he works hard. I'm not going to give any player less than the standard 6 today, so he gets a 6. And there's no subs to mark, is there? So there you go. So can you figure out my City's a man of the match? Well, it's 1 of 3, isn't it? So yeah, I'm going to give it KDB. Say it could have been Mahrez, but he just didn't do enough in the first half. So, yeah, I think KDB's a safe bet, really. And same with Sterling. It could have been Sterling for good goal, but he did miss up other opportunities to put in the game to bed. So there you go. Right, on to Pep Watch till 2023, possibly, perhaps, maybe. Yeah, looking at him at the moment, yeah, it's very, very possible, isn't it? Yeah, no subs. I can sort of see this. A lot of people weren't happy with that. A lot of people wanted him to bring players off like KDB, but... you're just as likely to pick an injury up, and certainly against Fulham who weren't particularly physical, you're just more likely to pick an injury up in training. So yeah, give him the 90 minutes because let's face it, these guys have a 7 day rest now. So I totally agree with what Pep did today. There was no one was injured, no one was struggling. He wanted to give KDB had had a rest the last game, so he wanted him to play the full 90 to get his sort of match fitness back. So I sort of like that. I think it was quirky Pep, wasn't it? This is the Pep we like to see. This is a little bit different from Pep. So I'm happy with that. I thought that was probably the right decision, although some people weren't happy with it. I think it was. So, yeah, I mean, interesting, obviously. Is that a starting 11 for United? I don't think it will be. I think it'll be one or two changes. And a couple of players have a chance to play themselves in, don't they, against Marseille. So, I'd say he did say, obviously, that I'd love to see Foden have a great game against Marseille and actually play himself into the reckoning. But it'll be interesting. But I certainly don't think that'll be his starting 11. Any comments after from Pep? Well, the only real thing, he did have few things. He was asked some questions by the press, but obviously on Raheem, he said he always tries. I have no doubts for a striker. It's always important to score goals, and that's what he's done, so it's good. So, yeah, he was asked about KDB and stuff like that, but there's nothing really exciting to actually comment on, really, with Pep's comments after the game. We had John Stones talking to the City Channel. He went on to say, "We said after the Champions League game we wanted to keep another clean sheet," said Stones. "Today was a tough opponent that we did a few days work on after the Porto game, and we knew what we were up against. We said it from the start that we want to keep the wins going. There could have been more goals, and in every game we play we could score more. We're frustrated with ourselves and we're happy with the 3 points. It's something we can learn from ahead of the next game. It's always the same competition for places," he said. "The manager demands a lot from us and he expects a lot from us. When there's a chance, we've got to take it. It's a healthy competition. We know what's expected. If we don't deliver, then we know someone else is fighting for that spot. That served us well over recent years. Everyone has a high standards and keeps them there, and that's what the manager wants. We're happy with the 3 points. It's another step forward, another chance to put a mark on this season. Take it game by game, see where it takes us. I could say before the game, everyone's words, and that's inspired onto the pitch. We've got to keep this winning mentality going in every game." So that was Mr. John Stones. Quirky stats. Here you go. Up to Joe. Manchester City are unbeaten their last 39 Premier League home games against promoted sides. 135, drawn 4, winning the last 7 in a row by an aggregate score of 21-1. Kevin De Bruyne has made 14 assists in the Premier League in 2020, the most of any player in the competition, more than twice as many as ever on any other Manchester City player. Just shows how important he is to us. Raheem Sterling has won more penalties than any other player in Premier League history. Well done, Raheem. You should have had even more, shouldn't you? Let's be honest about it. Manchester City are unbeaten their last 16 meetings with Fulham in all competitions, 1-13, drawn 3, winning the last 10 in a row by an aggregate score of 29-3. This was the first time Manchester City didn't make a single substitute in a Premier League match since April 2005 in a 2-2 draw with Charlton. For the first time in 416 games as a manager in the top, this was his 250th game for City as well, Pep, wasn't it? In the top five European leagues, Barcelona, Munich and Manchester City, Pep Guardiola didn't use a single substitute in a league game. So that's the first time in 416 games in the top five. Stat City, Man City have not conceded a single goal in their last 5 matches against Fulham in all competitions, their longest such run against a single opponent. Man City have now, can we play you every week? Man City have now scored 100 goals in 2020, the 10th year in a row that the club have reached at least 100 goals in a single calendar year. Well done, boys. Man City have now won 300 matches in the month of December in all competitions. Happy December, City. Ryan Sterling's opener today was the 50th goal he scored at the Etihad under Pep Guardiola. Well done, Raheem. Man City have now scored 400 goals in the Premier League under Pep Guardiola. 400. This is Pep's 250th match in charge of City in all competitions and the 700th of his managerial career. Well, 70-odd% win rate as well, just over 70%. Very, very good. Raheem Sterling is now Man City's leading goal scorer this season with 6 goals in all competitions, overtaking Ferran Torres with 5. There you go. Some of the headlines on the City site. City ease to victory. Yeah, the word ease is used a lot. City ease to victory over Fulham. The Independent, City finally move into the title picture as Kevin De Bruyne and Raheem Sterling dispatch Fulham. Sky Sports, Kevin De Bruyne and Raheem Sterling fire as Pep Guardiola's men Return to swaggering best. Well, okay, a bit over the top there, mate. Sky Sports, not like you. The Guardian, City East past Fulham with KDB and Sterling sparkling. There you go, they were sparkling. I could see the sparkles from where I was watching. Being Sports, Guardiola victorious in his 250th game in charge. Well, no lie there. Daily Mail, City cruise to victory over the Cottagers. We do, well done. BBC, City continued their return to form with another one-sided home win, outclassing Fulham to move up to fourth in the Premier League table. We won't be there at the end of the day, though, will we? There you go. Yep, so in conclusion, interesting game, not spectacular. Again, let's face it, against one of the favourites against relegation, let's face it, a lot of our wins so far have come against teams well in the bottom half. But you can only beat what's in front of you, is the old adage, isn't it? That's what they say. So, yeah, I think as far as City are doing this season, I think we'll learn a lot more next week, won't we, in the big game next Saturday, a week away from now. But that's going to tell us a hell of a lot more than this Fulham game will, or a hell of a lot more than the Marseille game will. So that'll be very interesting. Anyway, thanks for joining me. Of course, I'll be back with a preview of the Marseille Champions League game, which is at Etihad, 8 p.m. kickoff on Wednesday. Oh, I'm up early on Thursday as well, so that's going to be a bad night. I won't be able to sleep properly. Oh, well, never mind. I'll be back on, obviously, on Tuesday. I'll put that out, the Tuesday, a preview of the Marseille game. And please check out my Citizen channel, City Past and Present Vlogs, including, obviously, the Found World. Now got the Found World of Manchester City, where I open up some memorabilia live on camera and show myself up by not knowing too much about my club from 1960 odd onwards. So there you go. But that's episode 5 is available now. Cover stuff I bought between 1962 and 1996. So check that out. That'd be fantastic. Please check my links on screen. If you follow a friend me on Twitter and Facebook, I do follow and friend everyone back. I do check every couple of days. So if you want some followers, etc., I will reciprocate. And of course, moviegamenostalgia.com is my little website, my own personal website for old and rare DVDs, movie posters from the 90s and 2000s when I used to have a video shop in Manchester, some great films, some great actors, some board games on there as well. So if you ever get a chance to, if you're bored and you're flicking through the internet, have a look at moviegamenostalgia.com and that'll be absolutely fantastic. Anyway, thanks for watching today. That's until we meet again on the Citizen channel. Perhaps you'll flit over to the film and TV channel and watch one of my film or TV drama reviews, etc. That'd be fantastic. Until we meet again, guys, please take care of yourselves, take care of your friends, take care of your family. Let's all take care of each other. And until we meet again, please stay safe, Blues. Further saying, goodbye for now. Thanks for watching.